What position's that?
Planning board.
Oh, yeah, we have four people now?
Four people going for the two seats, yeah.
I thought there was like deadlines for that one.
Not for the appointments, for the appointment you said you did.
Oh, okay.
Okay, let's get started. Call the meeting, the planning board meeting, town of Hopkinton, for Monday, May 9th, 2016. Start off with thanking HCAM for recording the meeting tonight. We're down one member right now, so you can watch that if he does come in a little bit late. From an agenda standpoint, two of our public hearings are going to be continued or withdrawn. The first one is the solar farm on Hayden Rowe. So if you're here for solar farm on Hayden Rowe, it'll be continued very shortly to May 23rd at 7:35. And then also the Waterfresh dividing the residents from there. They've decided to withdraw it because of the few members that we have there, and they'll resubmit it right after the town elections. We've got the 25 Ash Street hearing coming up at 7:30. We're going to spend some time among the board talking about master plan today. And then we also have Legacy Farms kind of to finish up the evening. So let's start off with the public hearing on 201 Hayden Rowe. I'd like to accept a motion to extend the stormwater management special permit to June 13th.
So moved. Second.
What?
You're extending the time to make the decision.
Yes. To make the decision till June 13th. And we had that on a letter from the applicant requesting that. So further discussion? I see none. How do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And then entertain a motion to continue the public hearing until the 23rd of May at 7:35 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
Yep.
Point, I am out the 23rd.
Okay.
Just FYI.
Okay.
We'll have a full board by then, and you'll have to watch it.
Yeah. Fair. Just so I just want to let everybody think
okay.
A little business travel.
Well, that's not a bad thing. Okay. All those in further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, that takes care of our 7:30 business. Okay, the next I'd like to do is a couple of A&Rs, and this is approval not required, 139 Fruit Street. I think you lucked out today.
Oh, I did, thank you.
You want to explain what you're looking to do?
You have the plan, you've seen the plan, I take it?
I think we have a plan in front of us somewhere.
This is an unusual situation where the homeowners want to refinance their house. They've made an agreement with Evolve Bank and Trust out of Columbus, Ohio, who will not put a loan out on any piece of property bigger than 10 acres in size. Why? I called them up. I said, doesn't it make more sense? You have more equity if it's a 12-acre piece? They said, yeah, but that's just one way to do it. So we have to chop a 2-acre piece off of this thing so there's one piece that is under 10 acres that they'll put the mortgage on. He has no intention of selling the 2-acre piece. He has no intention of developing the 2-acre piece. That's why we wrote on it not to be considered a building lot. He's not even going to change the deed. This is strictly for mortgage purposes, so they'll put the lien on the mortgage on lot one, the larger lot over there. If someone wants to come back in and move the lot line on lot two 1 inch and say, hey, we're going to make this a buildable lot, they can do that in the future if they ever decide to.
And so I just had a concern that they're showing Prospect Street on the A&R plan, mm-hmm. which we don't recognize as either a public or a private way. And I think I mentioned there's a 1972 plan recorded at the Registry of Deeds that shows it as abandoned. So my concern would be that if someone does do that and goes back and says they have a buildable lot, now they're showing they have frontage on a street that the town does not mm-hmm. recognize as a street. And so I had asked the surveyor to remove Prospect Street from the plan or to label it as abandoned, and he had some concerns with that. So I asked him to be here to explain that to you.
The problem with abandoned, and I have that plan from 1972, I have a lot of plans that show Prospect Street. It used to run all the way back into the Roosevelt Farms subdivision. And I ran the plan indexes and the deed indexes for any sort of a discontinuance of that road and could not find anything. The deed for the person across the way, let me stop for 1 second so I can come to find this one. The deed for the person across the other side of Prospect Street says that they go up to the edge of Prospect Street to the stone wall that's on the opposite side, but no further. There's nothing that says this thing was discontinued, sold to anybody else. I have to label all the abutters on the plan or something, so that's what this is. Again, we're making no... Well, thank you. Oh, yeah, here's the very last one I have.
By definition, everything I lose, the first place, the last place I look is where I find it.
Yeah. So they label the street, Prospect Street, abandoned. Now, abandoned could just mean no one's using the thing. It could just be a paper road. I have it on a plan from well back a ways. But there's, like I said, there's no discontinuance of it, and there's no deed showing that it was given off to anybody else. I personally think it's still there, but we don't care for this plan. That's why we label the thing not to be considered a building lot. This is Prospect Street when it was created back in 1854, where it starts off of Fruit Street and runs. This is all back into the Roosevelt Farms subdivision in here. The property we're talking about is up in here. I'm not going to get into what they did as far as getting rid of this on Roosevelt Farms. But as far as I can tell, there's nothing that has changed that from being a strip of land that is labeled on a plan as Prospect Street.
Lean, Jennifer, what do you, what's your recommendation? Does it meet the requirement?
I mean, technically it meets the requirements, yes. I just have that one concern.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask Elaine and Jennifer, what is the proper legal procedure for the town to discontinue a street? I know we've had things on the town warrant before discontinuing town meeting. So if we approve this tonight as is, where the homeowner says they have no plans to do anything different, could we go and formally get this discontinued next year, and that would not, would this be grandfathered in any way?
We could do that.
So that would be a resolution if we assume that there is no change planned for the next year to put this on our list of paper or non-existent roads that we've been wanting to clean up.
Sure. I mean, I think we'd probably want to have someone do a title search just to see whatever happened or how it became about.
Right. But we really should be out there looking for all these things and working to clean them up at subsequent time meetings.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
My concern is we've seen a lot of contention over these paper streets in the past 5 years that I've been on the board. And that would be my only concern, because it is labeled as a street, someone could come in one day and say, there's a street here.
At which time I would expect the board would say, we ran into this back in 2016. We're not certain of the status of this street. Provide us with a title search of this thing to prove that it is really a street. Again, I have to label it as something because I have no record of anybody owning it. The only thing I have is it showing up as Prospect Street. And, you know, as far as the word abandoned on that plan, I could do a plan that doesn't have to go before the planning board and label Main Street as an abandoned road. Doesn't mean it's true.
How much weight legally does it carry putting not a buildable lot on something? Is not that worth the paper it's printed on at the end of the day? when they label stuff?
That's important to put on A&R plans. That does carry forward. That is important.
So if someone were to look at Prospect Street and say, I've got frontage, the fact that it's been labeled not a buildable lot would trump somebody saying, I've got frontage on the street that you show?
I don't know if it would trump it, but it's important to consider.
Okay. So it does carry some weight. How much is debatable.
So technically, you think that there's a strip of land that used to be called Prospect Street, and Roosevelt Farm owns, I'll say, the other side of it.
It cuts through the subdivision.
Okay.
Yeah. But again, I don't care about what they do over there is their business.
Entertain a motion from a member of the board.
Can I just have, I'm sorry I came a little bit late. I'm not exactly sure what exactly you're asking for, Mr. Chair.
It's an A&R plan to subdivide a big lot into two.
They're refinancing, and the bank won't give them a loan on a 12-acre parcel. They're cutting out 2 acres.
It's got to be no more than 10 acres with this bank. I called them up and said, doesn't it make more sense you have more equity? He said, yeah, but that's our policy.
So the marking is not a buildable lot, not to be considered a buildable lot.
And this is going to be kept under the same deed. I don't know when that common law thing, when they put lots back together, falls into place. It might be 3 years based on the signatures on the approval not required plan. But eventually this thing is just going to go back together.
I don't understand the bank's concern that the lots be separated.
They won't issue a mortgage on a lot any bigger than 10 acres. He has 12 acres. I don't know. I know. That's what they say. He has 12 acres, so we have to chop 2 acres off so they can put the attachment on the mortgage on the 10-acre parcel.
Okay. So I think we have three courses of action to pick from. One, we can do nothing and let the town clerk sign the plan in... What, another week or so?
I believe it's the 17th. Runs out. Double check.
That's whatever. The date is not so important. And that's kind of do nothing as a planning board, though typically we sign these if we think that they're eligible. We're usually pretty quick at signing these things. The second thing would be to deny it for a reason that we don't like Prospect Street on the plan. Or we approve it.
And if we approve it, it's the same as it getting approved in a few days by the town clerk.
Correct.
We're just holding the homeowner up. It's not going to stop this from going forward and our concerns that something
correct
could develop, it'll happen.
Right.
Does it make sense to kind of potentially do a title search on that area? Right. They had talked about something you might have to do down the road. Is this something prudent to do at this time?
Again, I've run all the plan indexes and the deed indexes. Essentially, I've done a non-formal title search, if you were, and couldn't find any deed that went on it. I mean, it wouldn't matter to me if somebody owned it next door, and the assessor's office shows that the neighbor across the way owns all of Prospect Street. That's not what his deed says.
And that neighbor is Mr. Medeiros?
I don't know. Whoever is on the other side, I don't know his name.
They just refurbished the past year that Lou house, the farmhouse.
I think it's on the other side, but I'm not sure. Blue house is on the other side of Roosevelt Farms, I thought, maybe.
Lynn Busum Markinac, 151 Fruit Street.
Well, it appears that one way or the other, landowner's plan is entitled to endorsement, either sooner or later. so I'm taking no action. Doesn't really carry any weight further down the road. It just holds them up.
Okay.
I would think that we would want to just note to self as a board in the next year, along with other roads we want to start cleaning up, to address this.
We might have some budget in this fiscal year that we could start the process sooner than not. Get it going.
I move to endorse the plan.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Okay, seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Nay.
Anyone abstained? Okay, you need three signatures and a date.
Two signatures.
What? Two? Two? Oh, okay.
It's a lot of static on the monitor, so. Who wants it?
I'll take one of it.
Shouldn't the abutters have been notified, or is it for an A&R that's not required?
It's an A&R.
It doesn't make sense. They already have a
line on the public or something. There, it was your motion. You want to sign and date it? Okay. Let's get to the next one, which is the Tetlow lot on Hayward Street. Well, I saw Bill somewhere around here.
Huh?
Come on down,
no,
Bill.
I mean, it's an approval not required. You don't need to have a vote.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, all. How are you?
Okay, why don't you kind of quickly explain what you're trying to do, and you'll get a recommendation from the town planner, and then we'll get you on the way.
Well, for, I would say, 10 years, I've had about 12 lots down there that were postage stamp lots, and the tax department has hounded me to consolidate them all and make two lots out of them. So I'm finally bringing their wishes to fruition. But I had all these small lots down there that were useless to anybody. I just combined them. I've tried for 7 years to get that rezoned as rural business, and finally we came to some type of a compromise where I had a small portion of it rezoned as rural business, and I talked with the building inspectors, and we came up with the idea of making two residential lots there. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So lot two is pretty well wet, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, but it meets the standards.
Meets the standards, okay. Yeah. But it's... Okay. And both of them meet the requirements?
Yes.
Look for a motion to endorse the plan?
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
I just had one question.
Okay, go ahead.
I was just curious as to what this little boxed-off area is in lot one.
That the town owns?
That's a town-owned piece of property.
Yeah.
It's a little pool, and it was reserved for town use for in case of a fire. They could use it to draw water out for a house fire.
I read it as town, but didn't know that they actually had that little area. Okay, thank you.
I just have one question. Actually, it doesn't relate to this, but I thought the corner of South and Hayward had the restaurant on it.
It does.
What is 74? It's condominium.
That's been changed to a... last year I sold Dunkin' Donuts. And
right.
we transformed that land into a
condominium...
It's a business condominium.
Trust.
Okay, it's not...
Controlled land area, yeah.
So that's the old North Pond House Marathon or whatever it is now. It's still there. It's just the structure.
And the little house became part of that, or is, you know, prospect.
Okay. Completely confused.
Okay, we have a motion in front of us. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Need two signatures.
Thank you.
Why don't you ask the town whether or not they want to abandon that little piece of property?
But I'm going to abandon the other half of the road. We're not having much luck with woodway buildings.
Okay. So, let's see. Brian Gass at 5 Cobbler's Way.
Thank you.
These pens are not working too well.
Oh, I have more.
We're all set now.
That's good.
Does that need a second date or just one date?
Just one date.
Just one date.
Yep, all set.
And do I take this?
You take it and you file it.
Record it.
Most efficient meeting I've ever been to in my life.
Sometimes.
Thank you.
Do you want to rub a band?
So what are we doing at Cobbler's again?
Got two reasons to be here for you tonight.
Okay.
Number one is the chief reason is the changes at 2 and 4 Cobblers. The Board of Health is looking at house designs differently than when we proposed this subdivision back in 09. And oftentimes they are requiring that the basement be considered part of the septic system total. In order to build a four-bedroom home, oftentimes because of that finishable basement, if you will, we need 50,000 square feet to satisfy Board of Health requirements. The original lot was 46,000. So what we're doing tonight is asking to approve a plan that takes the land out of lot 2, number 4, and adds it to number 1 so that number 1 gets over the 50,000 square foot threshold. And we've reworked some lot lines in order to make the landscaping at number 4 flow a little bit easier.
And it doesn't affect the open space buffer around that?
No, it's all inside of the two lots.
Okay, so you're just taking buildable land and making it...
Swapping it around so that lot 1 becomes larger.
You're just doing coconut shells around that.
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
The second reason is something unfinished business from about a year ago. Up here at number 5, you may recall that the driveway entrance ended up in the open space.
Yep.
We came before the board to talk about transferring land in the back into open space so that that triangle in the front, the driveway and the two posts that served as the entry into the lot could remain on number 5. So this plan would be the official approval of that concept.
Okay. I think most of us remember that discussion back in the day. And it is entitled to endorsement?
It is.
Okay. Entertain a motion to endorse the plan.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Because it affects the open space, it falls on two sheets, so if you wouldn't mind endorsing both.
But we'll continue on with the Hehn Farm Summit Realty Trust. proposed three-lot subdivision plan at 25 Ash Street. So we'll open that public hearing, which was continued from two other previous meetings, if I remember right. So. Okay, why don't we start off with maybe an explanation of what has transpired since our last meeting?
We had the, we were in receipt of the concerns raised by Beta Group Inc., but it seemed to me the bigger issue was that parcel B, the strip between Haynes, Parker's Lane, and the abutter to the north, Camborellis. After much back and forth, what we have agreed to do is to shift the right-of-way of Parker's Lane northerly to the common boundary line, so that the northerly side, if you're standing at Ash Street looking into the parcel...
Let me unroll a plan here so that more people can understand what we're talking about.
If you're standing looking into the parcel, along that left-hand side was parcel B originally, mm-hmm. and there were some concerns raised about access into this abutting property by Camborellis. What we have done is to shift that right of way northerly so that that left hand side, as you're staring here looking into the site, is now along the common boundary line at the wall. Okay. At our narrowest point, we are 40 foot wide. The wall, the old farmer's wall, drifts as you move through here, but at no point are we less than the 40 foot way. So we get to 41 and change, 42 in a couple of spots. That area was absorbed into these two house lots. Mm-hmm. One, the existing home here, 25, and then lot 2. So parcel B has been eliminated on this latest design. The configuration of C to be donated to the town, D and A, where the stormwater sits, those are unchanged from the original plan.
And the area of the paved surface is pretty much the same, except for driveway's got a little bit longer?
Driveway's a little bit longer, correct. This is about the same location, shifted a couple feet northerly. We introduced a temporary easement along this side for the construction of the turnout, but we're still 12 foot wide, and in this location we're 18 foot wide to facilitate vehicles passing each other on Parker's Lane. So, in essence, this extra drive, this extra length, that extra length was added to those two drives. Well, in my mind, we've just shifted this up to here.
Okay, so go ahead, Claire.
Oh, I'm just a question. So if at some point in time later that road gets built out to the full size road to allow the neighbors to build back there, is that all going to be on Mr. Gassett's property, just the entire roadway width? Is that all on Brian's property, or would some of that stretch over onto the neighbor's property? Is there no wiggle room on Brian's property?
No wiggle room here. That fieldstone wall is the edge of Parker's Lane. It's now the edge of the right-of-way. So all the construction of the driveway, of the accessway, whatever form it takes down the road, is on 25 Ash.
So the full build-out road would all still have to be on 25 Ash?
Correct.
Okay. And right now, what is the width that will be proposed? Because I know there was discussion back and forth with the fire department as to whether you could do 20 or whether you had to sprinkle it. What's the
traveled way?
Well, I guess what you
the driveway that we proposed is 12 foot at this location here. We've got a turnout that's 18 foot wide, 25 foot long to facilitate cars passing each other.
Right.
At least one location along this to get folks in and out, but we will be 12 foot wide except for that location.
So,
and then they will be sprinkled.
And sprinkle so the two houses.
There will be fire suppression in these two homes.
Either or.
Right. So right now...
Why don't we limit it to talking about just the location of it, at this, and then we'll get to some of the other details?
Okay, I have just one more question on the road.
Yep.
So the amount of space needed for the full build-out is provided on Mr. Gassett's lane, but it's not going to be built out all the way. There will still be a strip basically unbuilt next to the Camborellis' property for now?
Correct. Yep, mm-hmm. That will be graded and loomed and seeded.
For example, if another unit was to be added off of that had frontage to that, would then require a full subdivision road, so it'd be 20-foot
right.
road
no.
as opposed to 12.
I understand that. I watched okay. the tape. I was just wondering whether it is unfortunate. I mean, any subdivisions or projects we've looked at, we always look for some kind of screening, and I know the neighbors mentioned they've lost some privacy, and the homes on that side right now will be looking straight into the backyard, which, you know, it would be nice if, for the time being, there could be some kind of vegetative buffer there along that unconstructed portion so that there is a visual screen between these homes and the neighbors, rather than looking straight into the backyard. I think that would be a win-win, particularly for the people buying Mr. Gassett's houses. It's just not the most sightly approach to be right up against somebody's yard. I mean, it shouldn't hold up the plan.
You get a nice
suggestion.
You get a nice stone wall out of it. Okay, let's go back to the number one issue first and make sure we have that resolved. Are the two parties now happy with each other, or at least come
yep.
to an agreement?
Michael Fee, Pearson Mandelfer, Diane Camporellis, and Daniel Haskins. I have a letter of withdrawal for our objections that we I gave you a letter back on March 9th, and then I articulated those objections at the last two meetings. I apologize that I haven't gotten this letter to you until now, but we were literally working on it up until about 4 o'clock. Yes, we are satisfied. We're very grateful to the board for encouraging the parties to talk. We're very grateful to the developer for being open to compromise. So we're happy.
And the proposed condition that was in the town planner's memo is okay?
Well, I had a conversation with Jen today, and we've kicked it around. You know, our position is that it's not necessarily relevant to a future board's decision-making with respect to a subdivision that would be on the Camporellis' land. If you, because that's going to come perhaps at some point in the future, one would think that it would be up to that board to make a decision as to whether or not to build out the road in its entirety. Janet made the point correctly that condition just correctly restates what zoning is, and that every subdivision requires that to be built out. I think by putting that language in the this decision suggests perhaps that the applicant in the future application might not have the ability to ask for a waiver. But when we were kicking that around, and correct me if I'm misstating our conversation at all, but when we were kicking that around, the consensus was that no, there's nothing in this decision or that condition that could be construed to be a waiver of the future applicant's ability to ask for less than full build out. So, I don't think it's necessary, but if you include it, that's up to the board, and we'll be fine with it.
Okay. So the big issue, I think, has gotten resolved. That's what I'm hearing.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, for us, for most for,
okay. So now we're getting into the technical weeds of it. Why don't you go through the technical changes that you've made?
Yes.
Okay, let's go through the technical stuff.
I guess what would be the view of the board? Item by item, would you like a quick summary of?
Yeah, why don't you just go through item by item
okay.
real quick. And you don't have to spend as much time if you and Beta are happy with it. Then he'll just nod.
This is the letter from Beta Group dated May 3rd.
Yep. Which I think is in your packet, people. Mm-hmm.
Page 2 with regard to zoning. Concern initially mentioned about setbacks of the home with regard to zoning. We have included the minimum side yard, rear yard, front yard, and the two proposed dwellings will meet all the requirements for front, side, and rear setbacks. Within the Section 8 design standards...
We just talked about that.
Yep. We've added, number two, excuse me, site distance, we've added a proposed limit so that the low brush will be maintained and that that full site distance envelope is available for traffic exiting the site. We've added a vertical granite curbing at the intersection of Parker's Lane and Ash Street to resemble what's on the westerly side. There is a detail in there. The concern raised by Beta may be the fact that, given that we are a driveway and there may be changes to this driveway size and configuration, that maybe the curbing could be optional.
Yeah, our thinking was simply that if the potential for expansion is somewhat imminent or likely, that asking them to put the curb zones in now, only change them in a short time, may not be necessary.
I think we're going on the presumption that we don't know.
Yeah. Right. Right. I think what they've stated is they don't know that when, if and when they'll build out.
Yeah. Fine.
Since you've got them in the drawing.
I do like that point because it's a financial burden that they'd be taking on, and I'm assuming we don't know the full nature of their agreement, but I'm assuming that the other neighbor will be constructing that side of the road when they expand it. And I was hoping there would be some pre-planning for that, if that's what your point is. Yeah.
There's no guarantee that a future board would approve the other subdivision, though. So perhaps we should build this correctly because you don't know what's going to happen in the future.
Right now the plan's got curbing in it.
Correct.
Okay. Number four.
Number four are one catch basin along the near the end of the roadway. Collects stormwater flows over that grassed area. There is, we feel, no need for a granite gutter mouth at that location.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay. So we're set with that. We have a potential condition for that one, I believe.
Yes.
Or a waiver. Right, sure.
Waiver.
Okay.
Number five, given the fact that we are the driveway 12 foot wide, it did not seem appropriate to include Cape Cod berm along the edge of the driveway. So we have asked for a waiver as far back as the original submittal.
I don't have a problem with that.
Yep. Anyway. That's fine.
Driveway to driveway.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Six and seven are interrelated. The feedback from the fire department was, because Brian was contemplating fire suppression in the homes, that the turnaround and the 20-foot width to the proposed dwellings can be waived by the department.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. So I think we understand that one. Go ahead.
I thought when we left off on that, was John's suggestion that it be 20 foot up to a certain point, which was the point that the neighbors would also need to have 20 feet to go to their property.
That's not how I remembered it.
Is that ring a bell?
But that was before these changes.
Sure.
Yeah.
But it's something I kind of thought we could keep.
People think that we have to go any part of this 20 feet. I personally would not pave anything more than you have to.
No, you've got to protect your stormwater and
the look.
The look and the impervious and what his basin is sized for.
Let's keep it at 12.
With the turnout, yeah.
Yes.
And I'm fine with that.
Okay.
Based on it, what the current conditions are.
Yeah, okay. As long as the fire chief is good, I'm good.
Six and seven look like we're good on.
Number eight, given the scope of this, we felt the sidewalk may not fit this particular situation and have requested a waiver with the original submittal.
This would be a sidewalk down the little individual street.
Along Parker's Lane.
Yeah, no, we don't need that. Okay.
We don't feel we need streetlights.
Nope.
Number nine. Erosion control. Based on feedback we received from Beta, we have added a sheet to the plan set
that
includes temporary diversion trenches, sediment traps, and some erosion controls. So we feel we have that covered throughout the construction period of the project with the plan, with a revised plan set. Number 11, we have added property markers on the right-of-way and the lot corners.
Good.
More in line with the subdivision rules and regulations.
Okay.
Number 12, we have highlighted the trees that are to remain on lot 1 and have also added a limit of clearing to the project to folks to be able to, I guess, assess the scope of the changes to the site.
Fine. I just want to encourage as much buffering as possible.
Okay. 13?
13.
This is
the depth of the pavement on the driveway. We feel that the what we have proposed is more appropriate for that use, even though the standard is the 4 inches.
Mm-hmm. Do you put that down in two courses or one?
Two.
Okay. And let's see, do we need to go through general?
General comments. Most of the issues are resolved. We've added I guess the key in all of that, we've added an access road for maintenance of the stormwater. We've created an easement over lot 3 so that some entity can access the basin and the forebay for any maintenance activities that are necessary. We clarified the plans. Number 4 clarified the plans to allow Beta to do a more efficient review. We have reworked Number 5, we have reworked the detention basin so that there is a 5-foot width at the top of that to access around the top of it.
Why don't you show us that on the map? I kind of remember from our first hearing that I had some concerns as to where the water went out or whatever.
This basin
maintains
a similar shape. The access now to get down here to perform regular maintenance activities will be through this easement here. A forebay has been added for extra treatment to the stormwater before we enter into the basin. This was widened, that berm along the top, allow access throughout the entire. We still have our spillway and our 3 outlet pipes here.
Was that where it was before?
Correct.
Okay.
As you know, we went to conservation to talk about the location of the wetlands resource areas and the resulting buffer zone to those. So we are reluctant to move that location and anything that contributes to that. So we felt it best to keep it down here on the southwest corner.
Okay, so we're going to be in a wonderful buffer zone to try to do a hiking trail across there. Okay, well, I guess that's going to be a challenge for Trails Committee. Okay.
Boy Scouts can build bridges, or
Everyone, else, you're happy now with the basin?
The basin's fine. We note that the construction details show the 2-on-1 side slope, which we're comfortable with. It's just your standards call for 3-on-1, so it may require a waiver.
Yeah, our goal was to eliminate that tree clearing. So by steepening up that downhill slope, allows us to fit that stormwater in a smaller envelope. We don't feel there'll be an erosion, sedimentation issue. Simply an attempt to retain more of the trees down in that corner.
Okay. And
stormwater management. We had a grass channel leading into that detention basin. We have now added a forebay, formalized that, and have reworked the calculations based on the addition of the sediment forebay. Some issues with regard to details on the plan, elevations, details for construction, and again, the grading on that slope. Well, worked out.
Looks like 4 is the only one we need to really talk about.
Correct. We have taken the federal soil maps and the Rawls rate for that class of soil and developed our stormwater basin designs on that. The suggestion is this, that it may be possible to conduct a percolation test to, I guess, micro-study that area of the detention basin and rework the basin accordingly. The accepted Rawls rate procedure seems to me to make the requirement of percolation tests superfluous, that we don't need to, in the middle of construction, rework that basin for a test that we ran in the middle of construction activities. I'd much rather figure out the size of the basin that we're going to construct now and move forward with that.
Haven't we done either a perk test or a soil log?
We did the soil logs.
Oh, so there's a soil log there.
A soil log.
So basically, with the soil log, you verified that the soil is what they're doing the calculations on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It seems it is not really a big issue. It was purely that when they excavated for the basin, to confirm that their assumption was correct before they complete it, so that if they do need to make adjustments, that they have the opportunity to do so.
It doesn't work. They're taking the risk, right?
This is very true.
So how much, or if any, standing water would you expect to have in that basin during a normal storm event, and how long would that remain? Is this such that it's going to have standing water for people?
No, I believe our goal was, help me out, Andy, if I've got it wrong. Yeah. 72 hours?
72 hours is the standard. I don't recall what your calculations were, but you met the standard.
Yeah, I believe we were shooting. So 72 hours, the storm water will be gone.
And what is the depth you're thinking you might get there? I mean, on a normal storm event.
How do you define a normal storm event?
The bottom of the basin is 452, and the outlet is 453.3, so 1.3 feet. During the largest storm events.
The reason for the 72-hour standard is to prevent mosquito.
That was my question. Right. What's the
so
time?
So mosquito, it doesn't have enough time for mosquitoes to actually
complete
the life cycle before it dries out.
Okay. So it sounds like we're happy with the basin.
And what would happen if we find out that it takes longer than 72 hours?
You're going to make it bigger or change the soil?
Change the soil? You can't really change the soil.
I mean, who's going to, right, who's making these changes?
Yeah, it would need to be reworked. Probably need to put some infiltration chamber or something like that in. But given the soil out there, I find that unlikely.
Okay. I think we're down to recharge of the groundwater?
Our basin handles our needs. Our detention basin, we just have been pointing out for the last 10 minutes, handles our need to infiltrate stormwater. So mm-hmm. there is no need for additional treatment, no need for dry wells around the homes, for instance, mm-hmm. because we have that standard met with the construction of the basin.
Okay, I think the rest all complies.
Yeah.
You have any other comments?
Nope. Other than that, I mean, there's a number of waivers or things, but other than that, plenty of time.
Jen, you got some waivers?
Yeah, I just want to draft conditions of approval and waivers.
Are there any public comments?
I have one question.
Okay.
With the movement of the drive, does that change the access, public access to whatever trails, the backland that's being gifted to the town?
No, we got to get it through Center School.
Okay.
Right, yeah. That piece that was being donated is unchanged,
okay.
And it will come from other town property.
Or across the Presswick.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, so you got any extras?
Yeah,
why don't you give those guys all a set of these waivers here?
Everybody?
Yeah.
as well.
Well, make sure they get a two, but then also give him one too, because he can follow along. How many you got? You got one?
Maybe 15 copies.
Oh, okay. Oh, here, give Dave one more hand.
Thank you.
Okay.
One more question, I'm sorry.
Sure, go ahead.
The address of the design professionals who prepared the plan, is that now on the plan?
It's in the submission package.
It was on the plan, too, was it?
Because I know in your memo you wanted it to be on the plan.
Right, and is it right there?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, I think what you're looking at is a series of waivers and whatever. So let me go through it. Basically, this would be the words of our decision, primarily. Environmental analysis not required due to small size. Cross-section of each street at 50-foot intervals is not required. These are all waivers. Existing and proposed street trees are not required to be shown on the plan. Location of street lights is not required. A separate and erosion and sedimentation control plan is not required. Deep hole and percolation test locations and results at individual house lots are not required because it's going to connect to the municipal sewer system. Granite curb along the edges of radius less than 100 feet, and that's except for the part that's out at the at Ash Street. Gutter mouths are not required. Cape Cod berm is not required. Width of the travel way will be 12 feet. Road will serve two lots, privately owned and maintained, and function as a common driveway rather than a roadway. Dead end street is allowed. The exceptional circumstance that we find is a donation of 4.75 acres. Turnaround is not required. Sidewalks are not required. Installation of street lights are not required. And provision of the construction requirements are not required.
I just realized I didn't add the waiver of the 3-to-1 slope on the basin.
So that would be item P?
Yep.
2-to-1 slope. 3-to-1 slope. Great.
Just as a point of clarification, E, there is a separate erosion sedimentation control plan in the package.
We do have it,
yep.
So we can get rid of E. Maybe make that 2-to-1 E. Okay. Then waivers. Because this new street will not be accepted and always remain a public way, all maintenance, repairs, snow plowing, stormwater activities will be responsible of the lot owners, not the town. Applicant shall be responsible for establishing appropriate permanent mechanism for undertaking such activities. Mechanism shall be in place prior to the issue of the first CFO. And a copy will be provided to the planning board. Road will remain private and service only two lots of common drive. In the future, if more lots are connected, the road will be constructed to town standards at the time of the new proposal and the developer's expense. On behalf of the town of Hopkinton, we thank you for your gift. Roadway construction will be completed within 3 years. In 5 years, maximum of two building lots, which does not include the existing house. Execute a new agreement with the planning board for lots 2 and 3 with a couple of conditions. Tree stumps and stuff isn't to be buried, which is pretty standard. Maintain all portions of the public way free of debris and mud and all that good stuff. All potential safety hazards, which will be done at the end of each workday. And no earth products should be delivered to site that aren't for use on the property. No earth processing, etc. Nothing to be done in the open space, I believe, is in there too, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
somewhere. If not, then there, it's somewhere else. Just a second. Erosion controls be incorporated. Easements on the plan will be deeded to the lot owners and the abutters. Disturbed areas for roadway and infrastructure shall be loomed and seeded during construction as soon as possible. Street name will be approved by the selectmen. We don't have the pay grade in order to do that. Streets will be swept. And then it's the last one. Open space parcels shall be used for storage of construction vehicles. Stockpiling.
Shall not be.
Okay. Any other conditions that the board would like to consider? Any comments from the public?
Well, the roadway construction provision that Jennifer drafted needs to go in there.
It is.
Number three.
It's number three.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
Okay, it was right there at the bottom.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Okay. So, what do we need? We need a couple of votes here, right? Or one vote? One vote to approve the subdivision with the following waivers and conditions. Any further public comment? Seeing none, entertain a motion to approve this subject to the waivers list and comments, et cetera, and conditions that we just discussed. That'd be 1 through 17. 1 through 17.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion.
Discussion, please.
Go ahead.
I do think this is very well written. I thank Jennifer for putting this together. Thank everyone for their input and discussion on this. I really do appreciate that the neighbors worked together, came to a solution. I think it's a good solution for the town and for the neighborhood. My major concern still is density. We've cut down the possibility of two side streets to one. So I think that's a win for us all. And I like the fact that, you know, there's a good attention to open space, and the stormwater management is pretty smart. Well done. I just remain uncomfortable with the whole driveway, but it is what it is for right now, and I think that number three really sums up the standard that we're expecting a future planning board to consider when they're considering a future project on this, and it seems to cover all the bases. So I'm not totally happy, but I'm very happy that it's worked out for the most part. So thank you.
Further comments, questions? We have a motion in front of us, right, Kobe?
Yes.
Okay. Ready for a vote? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Congratulations. We'll write something up in the next week or two.
Thank you very much.
Yep. Thank you all for working together.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay.
So.
Yes. Yeah.
Yet what? Oh, yes, that's a good idea. Entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, now we're getting on to 8:00, and it is a continued public hearing for 151 Hayden Rowe Street. Basically, the applicant has requested to withdraw without prejudice. And I think we have something in our packet here. This is the Water Fresh Farm application. I'd entertain a motion to accept the withdrawal without prejudice and to waive the filing fee. Submission copy only required for one. That we have, well, I don't know, we need the original findings of the Historic Commission. That's going
to
go.
He just doesn't want to have to go back to them again.
Yeah, that's correct. And they'll do a new abutters list, etc. But basically, they're withdrawing primarily because we had down to very few people. And they're going to resubmit this. They're coming back very shortly. So, anyway, there's a motion suggested out there.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, let's see where I am at. Now, Elaine had asked us, Roy, we got you coming up at 8:30 to talk about master plan really quick before that. And we screwed up the schedule so bad that you're going to wait just a few minutes if you don't mind.
Thank you for your patience.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right.
Where are we?
We have a working draft, minus one section at this point.
So let's talk about the one section. Which
what
you
section?
Two guys.
It's
the
done.
What?
It's done. It's done. Easy peasy.
It's done, huh?
It's done.
Submitted to?
Frank, did you submit it to?
Give me a minute.
So it's almost done.
So it's not for review this evening.
It's not for review this evening. But you guys are done.
It is done.
And you're happy?
It's done. It's always a...
Okay. You took a lesson from the Ash Street neighbors, or what?
Yes, we went to school, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
No friend dinner.
Oh, okay. Good. Okay, so...
So since everyone's been working on their sections separately, now everything's together, or will be together shortly, we need to read it all together, do some editing, make sure there isn't a lot of overlap, because I think there is some overlap with some goals and recommendations from one section to the other. So we should go through and read that with fresh eyes and, you know, kind of pull everything together. If there's anything that's duplicated in one section to another, we can streamline that and remove any duplication. You also want to flag any of the goals and recommendations for discussion by this board before you distribute it to other departments and boards for review and before you have a public forum. Make sure that, you know, you're where you want to be before you send it out for review. So I think that's the next step, to review everything, to get it into the shape that you want to send out for comment, and then hold a public forum.
And does that shape also define the tone and the voice, right? Because you've got essentially five different sections. You've got five different voices or points of view. Is that Ken, Jennifer, yourself, that essentially amalgamates? Doesn't necessarily
well,
change.
I think she edited most of the sections.
I tried to
okay.
edit it,
okay.
But keep the yeah. same. But keep the same flavor. If you find that something's not right, we need to fix that. Yeah,
that's fine. I just wanted to make sure that one person was kind
of did other people read through this whole thing? It took me a couple hours this afternoon. Okay. I, you know, it's got a lot of data. The only thing that we probably need to do is do a quick update on town meeting stuff.
Yes.
I mean, because we don't want to put...
There are some things that...
Some of that type stuff. But we kind of explained some history in that. And I think, you know, it's a very good historical document, I think. And also, it explains where we are and how we got there.
I also made a note, might want to add another goal to discontinue paper streets.
Yeah.
And it fits into one of the other goals, so we can just add that in.
Yeah, there might be some, but we've got the goals kind of listed by different group, but sometimes the chapters are overlapping in a way.
Right.
And so I don't have as much of a problem with full duplication, but maybe we can do the write it so that they say the same thing for each chapter or something like that. You know, just I wouldn't want one to have a little nuance of five shades of gray as opposed to you know, one flat.
50 Shades of Grey.
No. I was...
And so the way we've always organized it was to have, like, kind of like an executive summary in the front with all the goals and recommendations together, which is very useful, and then repeat them later. Also, you know, think about when you read through whether you want to repeat them later or you just want to have them in one place.
I think they go good at the end of each chapter. I mean, so I don't have a problem with that, and I also don't have a problem with the executive summary type stuff either. And I like the idea of that last sheet, which is implementation of trying to put a name by each one of these goals.
Yeah, we didn't have that before, so I think that would be helpful.
And that might make it more, you know, unfortunately, most of them might be, or a lot of them are going to be planning board, but maybe not. I mean, for the implementation plan, could we task you or Jennifer to give a suggestion of who might be responsible for each one of these goals?
Sure.
You know, I mean, you guys know how town government works as well as anyone does.
And the open space plan has the same thing in there, so it's not like we haven't done that before, so we can do
okay.
that.
Okay. Other ideas? I think we will set some time up over the next couple of meetings, because now we've got the book complete almost, as soon as he probably hits send.
So I'll incorporate that and I'll send it out again.
Okay. And
so rather than nitpick at this meeting, maybe if some of us have some input from what we've read, we'd better just to send that directly to
Elaine.
Jennifer. Yeah.
Yeah.
We can put them all together for your review at another meeting.
And maybe start using change type stuff. Mm-hmm. At this point, to think about where we're at. Yeah, there was a couple of nitpicks that I had too, but I don't think that that's the best use of everyone's time.
Just do track changes? Or
yeah, we'll do that.
Okay.
Or notes or
comments.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that way we kind of know where it's kind of coming from
and
who's doing it and why. And
we also will have to come up with some maps, so we'll be working on that as well. We refer to maps in here. We need to update the maps we had before or obtain new maps. And if you have any ideas for photographs, let me know. We can go take some.
Need some nice, pretty nice new photograph at the front of it, I guess. Okay. What other things? You got any suggestions for us? Nothing?
Yeah, I think just look for repetition, for overlap, for things that contradict each other that we need to work out as we go through here. There might be some contradictory items from one section to the other, here and there. And I have notes to cross out the ones we addressed at town meeting. So.
The only area that I thought we might hit harder, a little bit harder, might be the transportation was more general and it was big picture stuff as opposed to little picture stuff. Mm-hmm. That was the feeling I got. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Maybe we need to focus in on certain intersections. But they're all in there. So they were in there. It's just maybe an order of emphasis.
And I was thinking of keeping the sidewalk survey up until the beginning of June, maybe the first week of June, to get additional input. We have over 200 responses right this point.
Yeah, I encouraged my whole neighborhood to participate.
It's nice. They come in waves. I think as people put the link on Facebook pages and so forth, we get a whole bunch of it.
I don't want to be talking out of school, but does anybody have any sense of how this article got up on town meeting floor, sponsored by the selectmen that designated where the new sidewalks were going to go? It was like Fruit Street and something else. And we said, wait a minute. You know, where did that come from?
Ken and I both spoke against that.
We were within a hair of voting sidewalks without even...
Well, basically, I think what they did is they, at the end of the day, they picked something to generate some money, either that or the $133,000 worth of design money was kind of all they had left in a budget pocket.
But I think there were interim sidewalk results at that point, but that's continuing to evolve. So
yeah,
it's not set in stone, I don't think.
So it's So that, yeah, we got that clarified for me.
In the next time.
I mean,
if I may, part of that is, though, some of those last minute, and as we talked about our last meeting, we were asked to consider different streets, and we weren't ready to.
We're not ready. I mean, I don't, you know, you got to get all your input first, and then you're going to have to make some hard decisions, and maybe we're going to need a little engineering help of, well, maybe we put them in a priority, regardless of the money.
I think it's what the board had done before. You had prioritized.
But it's like you said, the easy ones we've done pretty much, low-hanging fruit, and the more complex ones are out there, and
you know,
they really need more consideration.
Yeah, you might need more money. Anyway, okay. So let's see. Thank you, Elaine.
Okay, you're welcome.
Thank you.
All right. So I'll put in economic development as soon as I get it.
Great. Okay, so now we're almost back on schedule again. We're talking about Legacy Farms. Roy, come on down.
Evening.
I will have my paperwork reshuffled. Okay. At this point, we'll reopen the continued public hearing. This is an application to amend the Legacy Farms Master Plan Special Permit for Legacy Farms Road North, which is a proposal to increase the number of dwelling units by 180 age-restricted units. And basically, we had not talked about this in a long time, partly because we're trying to get resolution on our neighboring safety hazard issue, the LNG plant, and I'd like to tell the board that I think Roy's come up with some mitigation items that, if we can verify them with our peer reviewers, that they seem to be like they might be a solution to the big vapor cloud problem, which was identified in the Sleffman study.
This is what I emailed you today, if you'd like that.
Yeah. The whole thing before we get to where we get to has got to be peer-reviewed. I mean, I worked in that industry for a while. I'm not going to have that done without guys that really work in that industry today, you know, really look at it for a while. But it appears to be reasonably well. Now, having said all that, then we've got a couple of these conditions that we've had in Jennifer's memo that have been around for a little while. And, well, let's go back on the study. We could decide to go ahead and do something tonight and go ahead and approve it subject to something like that if we wanted to, or if people felt comfortable with that, or we can kind of continue to let it slide. I think if it's after the election, we've run out of people to do 6 votes.
Correct.
And so it'd need a lot of votes tonight, basically, to get there. So that's one issue for people to be considering, and I think we'll have a potential wording change for a condition that might work if we wanted to go ahead with that. The second condition is the clean condition that...
I don't know if you have the most... Do you have council's most recent version?
No, I guess I don't.
Okay.
Why don't you pass those out? As of today sometime?
I don't have either.
No, these came back in March, but I was holding them because you indicated we weren't ready to proceed with them. Okay. So I didn't want to confuse everyone with too many versions of the same thing until we knew what we were doing. So I don't think his changes are too drastic, but so this is his most recent clean version.
Okay, so condition number two, I just go to the clean version. It basically increases the number up, adds 180 to the unit, and restricts it no more than 15 can be single-family dwellings, which is what the zoning change did. And the rest looks kind of editorial. And I don't have too much trouble with that personally. But if I look at, I think it's condition three. How could we start with condition two? Oh, this is condition two because we're amending the regular. Okay, so condition number three. Condition three, I don't think is written right at all. Basically, condition three allows legacy farms to not make the decision as to whether they want to go forward with the senior housing or not. So they can defer that decision. It kind of gives them an option. And then it talks about if the building permit for that has been issued, they shall not. And to me, I would rather get it to the point where, number one, you're going age-restricted or you're going commercial. Now, do you got a buyer for the age-restricted at this point?
Well, we had this conversation 6 months ago, and also with Ray Maris too. And I think the understanding was we definitely want to do the age-restricted. However, for whatever reason, if you didn't allow us to do that, we have to have some fallback. It just can't be nothing.
Well,
so our intent is to do the age restricted, and you know I'm perfectly fine. I think the language is if we pull one permit, we can't do any commercial, just one unit.
Yeah, well, that makes sense because the way this does here just doesn't make any sense to me. I mean, if you pull one residential in the middle of the commercial district, then you've made your decision.
There's no question.
For what it's worth, I remember it the way Roy's saying it, but to Ken's point, and we're just seeing this legalese and coupled with the changes that Ray is suggesting, the changes, and then the clean versions. The clean version for number three seems to be different than the changes on number three, so... at least doesn't make sense. Maybe a few more reads through it will meld in my mind. But is this something we need to absorb all right now, or is it something we can read later? Kind of bring my glasses with me either.
Or is there a way it can be restated?
Well, and then the question is if we do that, if we go ahead and do it without town council tonight. I don't know whether we're comfortable. I mean, we could write something, but we might write. I mean,
can someone explain something to me? Sure. I don't understand this on number II on that in red. If a building permit for the 121st new dwelling, what does that mean?
It doesn't make any sense at all to me. His changes don't make any sense at all to me.
I mean, I don't understand it.
I mean, that should be, if a building permitted...
I see what he's saying. He's saying you're going from 1,120. Once you
121.
But it's 940.
Oh, I see what you're saying, because it's 940 plus 180?
Yes, yeah. But that's
1120. So what he's saying is if it is a building permit for that...
If a building permit for the 1,121st new dwelling unit has been issued. That makes no sense.
But it makes no sense because you won't ever get there.
You won't ever get there.
I mean, it
so breaks. Why don't we just... Okay, I'm very happy if you just change the language to we can only pursue one or the other, but not both. We either pursue the age-restricted or we pursue the commercial, but you can't do both. The minute you build one residential unit...
You're committed.
You're committed.
Right.
And, simple and as that. And that's what we did the south side, actually.
Like above that 121, it says maximum number of dwelling units is 1120 or less, then commercial shall not exceed 450,000. I thought it was the other way around, that once you decided to throw in with the 180 age-restricted, immediately knocked it down from 450 to 250.
No, but I think what it says is if you do the 1120, shall not exceed either the 450 or the number of units. Now I understand it. It's poorly written, but I understand
it. Better before.
I thought the intention was to have flexibility, and I think, I don't know if the intention of Mr. Miaris is to allow that or not allow that.
Now I understand what he's saying. Basically, what he's saying is if you build the 1,120 units, you can't build the 450,000 feet of commercial.
Well, you can't do that if you build 941.
I think Ray's numbers are wrong.
Ray's numbers are fully wrong.
I mean, he's looking to allow the 180 and commercial. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And this is a clean one. The line's crossed out.
No, he's got the numbers all wrong.
I don't understand. Let's see.
There's original changes and then there's a clean changes.
Do you have a clean version that's more succinct?
If an original changes.
This is the clean version we had been working off of.
That one.
It's on the bottom of that page.
That one's better.
The old one made sense. This is ridiculous.
Yeah. So where is it? Oh, here.
Yeah.
On the original version that's not cleaned up, the way we just got handed, it says if there's less than 1120, then you could not exceed so many space, but so much square feet of commercial space. So that seems to be flexible, but then it's the opposite in the clean version.
The old one makes more sense to me.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. The old one is either or.
You know, there's an old expression with lawyers, the enemy of the good is the perfect.
Yeah.
So, Mr. Chairman, I don't think there's an answer to Frank's question about does this need to be vetted out, finalized tonight, or...
Well, the problem is if we don't finalize it tonight, then we'll start at that point. I mean, there's a little bit of uncertainty on the safety issue. I think, for me, it's a lot less. But if people were being conservative, you would finalize that in its entirety. You know, have the peer reviewer say, yeah, everything is cool.
I will say that you did, in the town meeting last year, Article 30, added language, which I think you could actually add to this master plan, special permit revision also. It says, adequate mitigation has been provided with respect to any conditions impacting the on-site safety, whether such conditions are created on-site or off-site. I think that if you added that, that would be very beneficial towards...
And that's over here.
you know, resolving that issue, because it gives you... When we do go to site plan review, you can then revisit this issue and say, gee, we're satisfied, we're not.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense. I hate to go back to the drawing board for this after the election.
I thought that was our consensus last meeting, but either way, we need more information.
No,
clarity.
At our last meeting, we did not have a mitigation plan that most likely will work, but I'm not saying it's 100% yet, just because.
But we haven't seen that.
We haven't seen that formally, and we haven't seen it formally via in a peer-reviewed fashion.
Can we talk about? Is it
sure?
Can you explain, is that with a wrap on the fence?
So I've had numerous conversations with Ken and with our consultant, also numerous conversations. One was the concept of putting the gas lanterns around the perimeter of the facility, some closer where it's near a residential area, other areas a little further apart where it's not as relevant.
A gas lantern being what?
Gas lights.
Gas lights.
Natural gas lights. So these lights would be on 24/7, 365. So if there were a vapor situation, cloud, let's say, and it moved across in our direction, if it weren't ignited by the facility itself, it would for sure be ignited by these gas lanterns, because the minute it hit those, it would ignite. Mm-hmm. And the minute it ignites, it flames back to the facility. So it doesn't continue, it flames back. Now, in a worst case scenario, and this was another thing Ken asked us to have the consultants look at, in a worst case scenario, if you had failure of all three tanks, and all three tanks filled the dike area, and there was a massive pool fire, so we say, likely it was one in a million years, but let's say that happened, what would happen? There's a 360-meter radius around the closest point of the dike. I'll call that sort of the safety zone. Anything inside that zone is not safe. Anything outside that zone is safe. So we have taken the gas lanterns, done a radius on the gas lanterns in terms of what would the zone be for those. We've done another circle for the pool fire, 360-meter diameter. We've done another one that shows, and this is in concurrence with exponent iomosaic and CH4, of the liquefier and the vaporizer zone, which is also on the plan.
So you're, this map here is your cost and expense. You're putting these up for your safety, our whole safety, but which is appreciated. But I don't know if the town or the you as a developer has approached the gas company and said, hey, we have concerns, and maybe they could provide some mitigation.
I think we'd absolutely be wasting our time, because what they will tell you, because I've had this conversation with them, I'm just frankly, just to move things along, willing to put the lights in, pay for them, pay for the operations, etc. Because I will tell you, they're not going to waste a dime doing it, because their response to me will be that this is not required, you're wasting your time and effort, not necessary, not required. So, is this a little bit of belt and suspenders and sit down? Yeah, it probably is, but if it gives everybody comfort, mm-hmm. we're willing to do it.
Richard Historic, too, doesn't Boston have those old plates?
Look, gas up and down lights. Commonwealth Avenue in Boston, yeah. It's all those lights along the street are all gas lanterns. They're on 24 hours a day.
What does this exclusion zone otherwise do to the placement of the housing that you planned?
It has no bearing on anything the Pulte's doing. It will have a bearing on the age-restricted in that.
That's what I mean. Like, yeah. Could you still place that within?
No, we can't. We're going to have to reconfigure it to some degree. We're going to have to push it a little bit further back and turn it a little bit. Because our current plan, if you look at the radius of the circle, actually, if you look at, and what we did is we actually put the 99-acre exclusion zone on here, now so you can see that. So this, you see that line there, nothing can be built here anyway. So the only thing that's being affected is this piece right here. Now, did we have some housing in there? Yes, we did. So that'll have to get moved back further.
So what would that distance be going from the?
It's about 1,100 feet.
There was also discussion about some fortification where that gas line goes under the road, because there's just some jersey barriers and things. Were you going to add to that?
I think that that's the town's responsibility.
Okay, and that's
personally,
something we might look into.
And I think that the selectmen are about to take that
okay.
up.
Okay, all right.
And hopefully you'll be part of that.
I would actually I would recommend doing that.
Yeah, can't hurt.
I think, you know, it can be done on the town's roadway and can be done, you know, hopefully they might be contributed to by the gas company, but you know, when you identify a risk mm-hmm. like that, you ought to go right. solve it. Now, the beauty of this plan is if the gas lights were in place, that huge cloud that was shown in the selecting thing would remain on their property only. So it doesn't matter whether it was from that fault or from any fault on it, it's got it solved.
It's like having a ventilator in the gas
stove. No, same idea.
Same idea.
Can you just share one of those with the board?
Through you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
How much were the expense of running these lights?
About $20 a month per light. So it's probably about $4,000 a year.
I'm going to give you one of mine back. I get some comments on it, but we'll talk about it another time.
And in these areas, there are already safety lights from the gas company, electric, so it wouldn't really be messing with the sky so much.
Oh, these are very subtle. I mean, these are actually charming.
Approximately how many of these gas lights?
I think it's about 14 of them.
14?
And that's some, you know, we've been in conversation, but, that's something that needs to be peer-reviewed.
Okay.
You know, I have no idea how this gas cloud exactly goes over the world, but it seems to be, I think it sounds pretty good with what they've done. It makes sense to me, but I'd like to have somebody who probably understands gas clouds a little bit better than I do say, yeah.
And is there any precedent for this type of solution?
Yes.
Yeah, there is, and I spoke to actually Io Mosaic, who's one of our consultants and exponent, both thought this was a good idea. And I think you should have Sanborn Head look at it because I think he's very good at what he does.
And the gas companies used to do something very similar to this. Yeah, and then their insurance companies weren't so happy with it because basically, as long as it doesn't ignite, it's still okay. You know, it's kind of that. So when you, while you're limiting the damage of what's going on if it goes there, you know, there's usually a low probability that the facility itself would trigger it. Obviously, the internal flame. You know, that if that's burning, you know, you potentially could do it. But you spend a lot of time and money putting up explosion-proof electrical motors. All your control panels is purged with nitrogen, usually, or something. So you just can't get all the oxygen out of it. So, you know, I mean, they have leaks literally all the time, every day. There's probably something leaking up there. You do not, you know, and they don't usually torch it on. But not LNG usually leaking, but, I mean, if you go out, if you've been to the Serenity House parking lot, you smell the gas.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
you got the flame. This is remediation under a scenario that has a very low probability of happening in the first place.
Right. So but it's
probability versus possibility.
Yeah. This limits the consequences.
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
Just to kind of go where Fran was going.
Yeah.
Is there another facility that has this solution, or would be the first?
I don't know. I can find that out, but I don't know.
It's a good question.
I don't think the gas company's going to like the idea, to be honest with you.
They probably aren't.
Because if there were a vapor cloud, they'd like to see it get as far away from them as possible.
Yeah.
And we're assuring that they're not going to share it with anybody.
Absolutely.
And the idea of, you know, them having the consequences of that staying on their property is not a pretty consequence, but it's a safe consequence.
Is it safe to say through the chair that as a property owner and developer, he's within his rights to do this? I think he is. So if the NSTAR has a problem, they can provide additional mediation, so it's not a problem.
Well, look at it. If they say that there's no problem with the facility, then they shouldn't really be worried about it, should they?
Right.
You could put gas lights
on it. It is a catch 22, isn't it?
Property.
Right. Well, unrelated. Yeah. Just because I like them.
Well, the other interesting thing that I looked. The other thing that I looked up. So we have an agreement with NSTAR on 99 acres of land that's a buffer zone, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And the very fortunate thing that's in the language, if they should complain, it says that they agree and will allow us to conform to any requirements of the planning board.
Oh.
So if you require it, there's nothing they can do about it.
Got it. Good. Your lawyers did good for that one.
Well, we didn't want to be out of compliance.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, while we're looking at this map, I must say the sidewalk has come along very well.
It's coming along.
Yeah.
They paved the whole North Road Friday.
I saw that.
Well, it's complete.
Well, the base coat is, yes. They'll be doing the sidewalk next. So that's in the next few weeks we should be done.
That's fantastic. I haven't been up there in a little over a week.
Get all the new signs in.
It's going to go last week, but it's too rainy. Things will get stuck.
Wait, just to understand this map, the little green circles represent what?
Those green circles are, Ken wanted us to find out what is the, I'll call it the leak zone, the potential for a leak zone. In other words, if two lights are 400 feet apart, what happens if some vapor were to leak in between?
And the rules, the wind direction was exactly down the center between two points, how far would it get out there so before it touched one of the other?
This is basically what the little lights would be.
That's correct. Yeah,
the blue and the lights, the green, the green, the green is the half-distance zone that a vapor could go before it ignites.
Okay.
The red line is something you want to stand on the opposite side of if it happens.
And then the big green circle and the smaller green circle, are those the exclusion zones?
Yes, the thermal exclusion zone.
Okay.
The biggest circle is the thermal for the tanks, right, and the smaller one is the vaporizers and the liquefier.
Okay.
Yes.
And we can reconfirm all that before we do this finalized. But even if, even if it's a little bit off, we're still pretty far away on those zones.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the which is kind of good to see.
Yeah.
Now, to me, if all the experts say this is really good, you ought to continue this picket fence westward and around the other way. But that's not Roy's problem.
No.
Mm-hmm.
That might be the town's problem. I mean,
well, I see it as an Eversource opportunity to make the town happy.
When was the last time Eversource ever went out of their way to make the town happy?
They honestly don't care.
They don't care.
Does Eversource own those tanks?
Yes.
Okay.
I was saying NSTAR, but it's now Eversource.
Yeah. They own them through a subsidiary, which they probably created to try to limit their liability for when it was Boston Gale. There was a shell.
Absolutely.
It's a shell with no corporate officers either.
Bermuda.
Anyway.
So, Mr. Chairman, what are the steps here?
Well, how comfortable are we at drafting language to do this special permit tonight? I'm not sure I am. Ray kind of botched it with the one.
Yeah, he did. I think your earlier version is a better version.
It's a better version, but now we got
conflicting versions.
I mean, I'm going to say that I don't think Ray understood what we were trying to say.
Or maybe he does, and then that's just the way he's written it, and it means something completely different to him because he's a lawyer than it does to us.
That's the risk we have if we go and vote something tonight, because
Mr. Chairman, can I make a recommendation? Could you consider voting the first version, pass it, with the understanding that you may require us to come back to tweak the language before we implement it? That buys you the option of...
I don't think... We cannot. I think there's a clause that says we cannot initiate amendment of it.
What if I offer it?
Yeah.
This is where I'm getting a little uncomfortable with. I hate to say it.
Where's the list of the master conditions? Like, how many conditions are we talking about?
You're asking the wrong person.
Some of these things are just rudimentary.
I think we're in a spot where we're really kind of close, but to me, I'm not over the line yet. And
but by moving it back, does it put the whole process?
We have to re-advertise that all over again.
I guess I'm just concerned with all the concern that's been about the LNG and all the material that we have reviewed with the board, and we sat down with the scientists, and this board, as constituted now, has got a depth of knowledge about that issue that a new board coming in is not going to. It's going to take a lot of...
Well, we're going to have that same bit discussion that's coming up, because we don't have a peer review. I mean, at this point, this is a concept that has no peer reviews for it. And there's a few little tweaks that I noticed that I gave Roy just a couple minutes ago that need to be done to it, but it's not, but I'm not 100% sure. And, you know, nobody is, nobody has gone through the document yet to even see whether the circles are the exact right. You know, that's what you do in peer review, is measure them out. I mean, not to be kind of negative, but I'm not so sure I'm ready to vote yes tonight. I think at the end of the process, I'm going to be ready to vote yes.
So I agree with Ken. I mean, I hate to push it back to the beginning, but...
Well, we didn't spend any time really on this. We're, you know, from... This is not like the Pulte one that we're going to have to spend a lot of time. We're talking about two or three paragraphs when the decision gets to go, you know, once it gets written right. So it's a, from a hearing standpoint, it's a, once we're done, we accept the report of the consultants.
My frustration with this particular one, you know, putting aside the
second
the
one.
LNG, well, it's not just second one, it's the fact that this is should have been relatively simple. And it's been lawyered to death, and it's turned. It should have been relatively simple. It's turned a lot of gobbledygook, and this one is the worst one I've seen yet. I mean, it's hard to even understand.
Yeah,
and it should be written in such a way that the average person says, "Oh yeah, I get that," yeah. And it's not.
Through the chair.
Yeah,
I agree that I don't feel comfortable at the present time, and looking at it. One of the uncomfortable ones is instead of tying it to the 941st new dwelling unit is more to, I think, what Roy, you had said, when the first permit is pulled for the first new dwelling unit in Legacy Park.
No, I agree.
As opposed to if all of a sudden... There are 600 permits down here, and you now start developing Legacy Park, you still haven't triggered the reduction under this language.
Right.
So what you want to do is once you pull a permit within that space, that triggers the reduction.
Yep.
I agree with that totally.
And I think right, like... Let's see, today is Monday, right?
Mm-hmm.
If we had a meeting on Friday night, we could still do it, right?
Sure, but I can't be there.
I won't be able to make it Friday night.
Okay.
I can't come Friday. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll bring my kids.
That idea doesn't work then.
I think it would only take 10 minutes.
I mean, if you can do it like right at 2, but I have to be in New Hampshire by 5 o'clock, so...
Does those people that couldn't do it in the evening, is there Friday afternoon type of thing? No? No?
We do a conference call.
What about Friday morning?
Friday morning at 8 o'clock?
That's fine for me, I'm here.
You can do 7 a.m.
I wouldn't be here. That's just the way it could be done remotely.
I'd make 7 a.m. work, so I wouldn't have to stay Friday night.
I can do 7 a.m.
I can do 7 a.m.
I can do 7 a.m.
I cannot and will not do 7 a.m.
How about 7:15?
Okay. I'm checking my schedule.
How about 7:30 on Friday morning? Are you a spot where you can phone in?
Probably could do that. That I could do.
That would be great.
I can do it.
I cannot do 7:30.
You 7?
I just need to be out of here by 8:30 on Friday.
This should take 10 minutes once Ray gets it right.
Well, no. I guys, we're all volunteers and we have a professional. Let's be conscientious of our time. We will meet again and maybe with Brian.
That's not the issue. Is you're going to lose Brian and Claire, and so then you won't have enough. You need 6 people.
But for this issue, we haven't really started discussing it, and we do have more data that we need. And I don't see us getting anything in time and ready and understood and read before Friday. I mean, we just got this tonight, and we see inconsistencies in it.
Is this new?
It's from March.
No, it's not.
And so no one's had it since March?
No.
no, that wasn't my choice, so I'm not taking the blame for that.
No, there's no blame. There's things happen, and it's we don't have the...
What additional data do we need?
Well, at minimum, we need something we can vote, which means through Ray.
That's fair. I agree with
that. That's, you know, the other data would be, do you want to have the LNG stuff done and peer-reviewed before you vote? That's another question.
That's
a question. I agree. And either of those two, you know, says we might want to wait a few weeks.
Would it really take that long to bring up the new members to up to speed?
I don't think it'll take too long to bring you...
Yeah, I don't think it's that. I think Ms. McDowell's concern is the refiling of...
But we're just talking... For this, there can't be more than two or three abutters within 500 feet.
I think it's the whole property.
Oh, is it the whole damn one?
Yeah, we're talking a big list.
Shit.
But... We have an election, we have some appointed members. For this, I think it's easier than for Legacy Farm North itself. But the good thing about Legacy Farm North is that they only really need to look at all the good stuff. Everything else is out of the way, and just the good stuff's remaining. But for this
That
issue,
process is already in hand.
Right. And for this, it why not take the same kind of... Yeah, process.
Can somebody educate me why he has to refile? Because there's new members.
New members. Basically, if you miss meetings or you don't, first of all, it takes six members to approve this. So if you only had a board with
seven
members remaining, we're seven members now. And we lose Claire. Now, we might not lose Brian because he might get appointed to the spot. So that would be six out of six, which if I was the applicant, I'm not sure I'd like to do that because that means that everyone holds a veto. And, you know, that's not fair to the applicant necessarily.
But the new members can't vote?
New members cannot vote on something that was heard before.
Okay.
If you refile, then all the new members can vote.
Okay.
And then you're up to a nine-member board.
Okay. Thank you.
And then it doesn't have to be unanimous, which is probably the right way to do it.
Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
Just thinking, there may be members in the town who might see us trying to push something through before a new board sets that maybe should or should not have, you know, in their minds,
mm-hmm.
should or should not have been pushed through. That could do a lot of ill will to the board.
Yep. I agree with that.
It's not a small thing.
So I'll be a veto guy, and I'll say if I had to vote on tonight, I'd be voting it down. So you don't want to call for a vote, I don't think.
That makes it clear.
Yeah. I mean...
The question to the chair, to the audience, as a presumptive future member...
Sorry, I'm just the public right now.
Right in members, you know, you could get, you know, but...
I mean, you don't really have a lot of other details other than maybe what we just passed out tonight, but, I mean, the people are voting, and you'll have time to come on up to speed on this. Being a new person, don't feel pressure on that, but there's information, summaries, and...
Right. Well, I think we've got a good story for this whole bit. I mean,
right.
You know, people...
So if we choose not to play it out here, if we choose not to vote,
got another appointment.
What do the timelines look like? He has to refile.
Well, we have four. We're looking for two.
You've got to get certified a butters list. You have to send out notices. You have to refile it, advertise it, and then have a new hearing. You know, my frustration with this, I mean... It's frankly not only is it unfair to us, but it's unfair to your board. And you were redlined, literally sitting at the meeting, and have you try and digest it to see if you want to vote on it. I mean, this should have been given to you a long time ago, because if there are discrepancies in it, it could have been vetted with Ray. you get a clean copy, everybody understands it, everybody agrees with it, then it gets voted on. I just don't know how it ended up like this.
Well,
to that point, if it was in our packet this week, and if we happen to read it, we'd have, I would have the same questions.
No, I would too.
But we wouldn't have the answers yet, so.
Entertain a motion to continue the public hearing to May 23rd, 2016 at 9 o'clock.
So moved.
Can I, before we close this, just ask a question about the concept? My understanding always was that on the, after the 940th unit was decision time as to whether you went the next step, and that knocked your commercial down to 250. I'm hearing a suggestion that with the beginning of basically the first unit on the north parcel.
No. The first unit in Legacy Park, which is the commercial, where the commercial stuff would go.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. At that point, yeah, it's all okay.
Yeah. That is definitely the intent.
I only ask that because, part of the thinking, we had questions about the age restricted from the get-go, even though it passed, and then part of the thinking when we did away at town meeting with the senior housing bylaw was this concern that, coming down the pike, over 55 may be just against the law as age discrimination, in which case it might cause everybody, including you, to rethink whether this makes sense anymore.
So I don't follow that.
Well, there's thinking that if you restrict housing according to age, it's a form of discrimination. You could discriminate against older people. You could, in this case, be discriminating against younger people, and that over 55 housing in general may be in jeopardy of being considered discriminatory.
I can tell you nowhere have I heard that in the federal government, and that'd be the place it would come from, federal guidelines.
We're hearing it.
I am?
Yes, and we haven't been able to enforce a couple of sales.
Keep options open.
But.
Mr. Chairman, you suggested extending it to May 23rd. Does that mean we could hear it on May 23rd?
If we had enough members, which I don't think we will.
Yeah, that was going to be my next question.
Well, I don't know. If Brian gets appointed,
you'll have six that can hear it, and it would have to be a unanimous vote.
Yeah.
And so the applicant wouldn't have to take that risk.
Well, why wouldn't we get ready to fix this the way we all feel comfortable with it? And if it looks like we have six that evening, let's vote it.
And if we don't,
we won't vote it.
Right.
So I think there's a motion on the table, but I have a question. What would be done in the interim before the 23rd? Is Ray going to then review the documentation and be able to get this out to us so we can review it prior?
Chairman and Jennifer, will make sure that we have language that we're happy with.
That we could actually have a vote on
the
23rd.
Yes.
But you're at the 23rd.
I am out the 20th.
Oh, wow.
No, well, that's not a good date. Good thinking.
Should I withdraw that motion because we need to maybe I withdraw the motion. Question, don't we have a deadline for the new members applying? Is that?
Not till 17th of May.
Okay. And then when's our meeting?
What if we...
So by the 23rd will be square.
What if we met later on the 17th, you're going to be appointing new members on the
17th. We'll be there, but...
Well, he'd have to get sworn in.
Will town clerk be here?
No. We could wait. We can maybe make that happen.
Yeah, I mean, it's Tuesday, so we're open till 7. The meeting with the selectmen's at 7, so I could check with Brenda to see if she could stay. Well, it'll be Brenda. It'll be whoever's elected. That's after the election. So.
Actually, anyone in that office can swear you in.
Okay.
I have a question. I completely understand Brian's comment about the perception on the part of the town of rushing this through, maybe. That is something to think about.
We've had it up for 6-7 months now.
Yeah, but
this is supposed to be ministerial. Yeah. I mean, this is pretty much...
I don't do that.
There's concerns.
I was just going to say, would it be worth at all thinking about my being willing to stay and be appointed to for the next couple of weeks to serve on both boards to get this thing done, and then the second appointment be made at a later date.
I'd rather get the whole committee going so that we've got, you know, the rest of the legacy farms going on, you know, how long that's going to take.
Right.
It's okay, so on the 17th, is everyone going to be here?
Yes, what time?
We're going to be here at 7:10, I believe.
Well, it's been moved to 7.
It's moved to 7.
I've been told to schedule it for 7. I don't know exactly when it will be heard at the selectman's agenda, so we'll be here at 7.
Why don't we post a separate planning board meeting for 7:30 on the 17th?
Well, you can just put, I'll just post one meeting and you can just adjourn to a different room.
Okay.
If I can find your room, I think it's a pretty busy night that night, but I'll try to do my best.
Time would be a little bit more beneficial for me. I have another meeting going on, but if you want to be here at 7:30, I will.
Can you not be here at 7?
We'll
try for the joint meeting?
That's important. Well,
as long as you have a quorum for that one.
Yeah, but the joint meeting, every vote is important to that one, if possible.
Right.
You're picking who's going to be sitting next to you.
For the next year.
You don't get to pick me, but you get to pick them.
Yeah. 7 o'clock. Yeah. How long are you expecting the appointments to last?
Is your other meeting in this building?
No, it's not.
Came on.
Right. That's my point.
Can we maybe, would it be better to push it later?
Later would be better, Mr. Chairman.
Can we see if we can push later on the selectmen's agenda?
Midnight?
No.
But I think the action items that Fran was referring to is that we need raise feedback and clarification, peer review information.
Peer review I don't think we'll have by the 17th.
I'd be shocked if that gets...
That will not be happening.
No.
So how can we move forward without information that we're...
Because we're not doing site plan review. You're going to put language before we do site plan review. You've got to satisfy you on that.
And the other hand is that you'd have to refile, and abutters have to be notified, and there's an expense with that. But I think we, speaking for myself, I don't see a problem with waiving that that fee.
It's not so much the fee, it's really the time and the whole process.
And you have to continue to a date and time certain right now, so...
I don't feel comfortable meeting on the same night we're meeting with the Board of Selectmen.
Okay.
Technically, can we share information with our presumptive members, and then we have 4 or more candidates that will be in place possibly on the 17th.
I see your objections. It makes sense. But we're talking about the next meeting following that be June 13th, unless we had a special one in front of it.
I mean, no offense to Fran, but we have new members, and Fran can catch the tape, and then...
There's no tape involved if we go that far, if we go with the new board.
I mean, on the 23rd.
From an advertising standpoint, what's the timeline on that? 2 weeks?
It would have to be at least 3 weeks.
So you could advertise for a June 13th meeting?
Oh, yes. Yes, we have time to do that.
Yeah. It's not even...
After the 23rd, the 13th is the next meeting, or is it the 6th?
That's
the 13th.
13th and the 27th.
Yes.
You couldn't make the 23rd from an advertising at this point.
Is there any value in rescheduling June to be 6th and the 20th instead of 13th and 27th? If it's a question of...
Well, it just fits into our schedule a little bit better, I think. Maybe. Entertain a motion to go to 7:30 on June 13th.
So moved.
What do you do? Are you
continuing?
I'm going to continue it. He might want to withdraw it and resubmit.
June 13th at 7:30.
Well, that would be if it gets moved to that date and
I'm good.
Well, make the motion.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
I moved it. I'm sorry if I wasn't clear enough.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That explains the awkward silence.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Second. Either way.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none. How do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Let's talk about the restricted land covenant. What did we have to do with that yet, Jennifer? We had that language all set?
Yes. And
finalized?
I believe you have. I will give you a new one, but I believe you have seen this one previously from town council. I believe it has a change on number 7, B7. And then under the public access, A, he had a small change, and that was it.
So B7, and what was the other change?
Under public access 5, A, was the fourth line down, there's a change. The spelling mistake, but... That's just to make it consistent with the vote at town meeting for the Marathon Museum.
Yep.
Question for the chair.
Go ahead.
So Jennifer, are you saying that the race change to number 7 addresses the vote we already take?
Yes, we have taken at town meeting? Yes.
Okay.
Because he wrote that before we took the vote. That's why it says with the 2/3 approval of town meeting.
Well, also you would probably have a vote at town meeting if it was a Marathon Museum, because we would have to convey the land over to that entity.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay.
So this is all set. So I think you just need to vote this, and then or you will sign it, and everyone can sign it, and then report it, right?
That's how it works. Are the only changes here the ones that are highlighted?
I believe so. That's what I've been made aware of.
If you find anything else, we won't hold you to it. We'll vote whatever else
looks
back.
Yeah, I mean, it looks fine from what I see.
Entertain a motion to accept a new version of the restricted land covenant for active and passive recreation.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
Are you saying that you should? Can you explain what you just said to Mr. McDowell, that if he has it reviewed by a lawyer and he does have changes, we don't hold him to it?
If there's something different from what was in there before, he hasn't reviewed it. He's just not seeing it. So if there's something different other than what's been highlighted by town council.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, so that got that set. Thank you. Other things for legacy. You're working hard on review of plans?
Yes. I think as I've communicated to Bowler, verbally anyways, that we didn't have any major issues with anything they presented. So
just about 20 pages of comments or something like that?
Well, between the back, you know, the document begins to get quite long once you have response and then response. And
gotcha.
That should be going out probably within the next 24 hours or so.
That's great. I just wanted to make sure that when we come to the meetings that you've reviewed everything, the construction management plan, the, I know you read multiple pages of questions, they gave you answers. So I'm hoping we can sort of bring that to culmination.
Yeah, our goal is that by the time we come back on the 23rd or whenever the next filing ends up being, that we're starting from a set point where everything at that point has been hashed out.
Great. Appreciate it. Thank you for your time this evening.
Thank you. Thank you.
See you soon.
Yep. Good night.
Good night.
You want to get out of here.
I was going to say, I think I'm all set.
I probably should let you out an hour ago.
That's all right.
Okay, next item is Jennifer has put together a list of meeting dates for the rest of the year. And you avoided most holidays, I would hope?
I avoided all holidays. Okay. And I tried to stick with the second and fourth Monday, because that, I believe, is your schedule. Obviously, it was unavoidable in some instances where there are holidays, so I did my best. And so that's the schedule aspect of it. So if there's any questions, there is one. I will point out there's one Tuesday on here, which is October 11th. October is a very difficult month for Monday holidays between Jewish holidays and Columbus Day and everything else. So Ken and I discussed it and felt like in order to get two meetings in on that month, if everybody could make a Tuesday, that would be good. So.
I have a question, and this may not pertain to me at all. Was 10/17 a holiday of some kind, like just to push it out 1 week instead of doing a Tuesday?
It wasn't, but it threw off. I had to avoid a day in November because Ken is going on vacation, and it threw off the rest.
No, I just meant do 10/17 and then come back again 10/24.
That'd be 1 week.
We've done that before.
Yeah. I threw that out there.
It was just a question, and like I said, it may or may not pertain to me.
So, I mean, if you would prefer that, we can do that, too. Whatever.
People would want to do it 2 weeks in a row, two Mondays in a row. That's okay. It makes it tougher on some applicants just because if they have one meeting, they only have, like, days to get something resolved. But who knows what it is.
It makes it tougher on staff to turn things around, but that's okay.
We might be dealing with... Well, I don't know. I think the school's coming in the summer. I'm trying to think of other biggies that are really coming on there.
Yeah, well, you never know. But whatever works for the board.
Which way do you want to do it? On Tuesday the 11th or on the 17th?
I'm fine with the Tuesday.
I have no life, so I'm available both days. So it's not up to me.
I'm not going to have an opinion because I don't know if it'll affect me.
Oh, okay.
It was just a question.
Okay.
Either way, I'm fine.
Why don't we leave it the way it is?
Okay. Okay. The other part of that is I'm requesting that the board consider changing their administrative rules to move the deadline for submittal of new information to Tuesday at 5 instead of Wednesday at noon.
I liked that.
Yes.
That would be helpful to staff.
Helpful to staff and helpful in trying to enforce late submittal.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm going to
start being more strict about
just one second.
Getting things.
There's one other change that I think we want to make for administrative rules. Do we not want, on page 2, you've got a paragraph that talks about prior to the submission, the application should first submit plans to the Director of Land Use Planning and Permitting. Do we want to change that to your title?
So we chatted about that a little bit, Kobe and I. I can, that's certainly fine, and I thought about that. I did not want to step on toes or make anyone upset, so that's certainly fine to make that change.
I think that's better.
Well, technically, Elaine is
She's not the director of land use.
That's not even her title.
Not her title anymore.
She has a new title, but she's still technically the town planner.
That's correct. And I did not say that. I would put principal planner in there.
She doesn't want things to be so big.
That's true. Yeah. She's very quick to send the phone calls to me.
So,
I'm not saying that.
Okay.
In a wrong.
I entertain a motion to accept the administrative rules to the planning board, the changes.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Okay. And that included the ones on page 2.
Yes.
Okay. The last thing, hopefully. Well, actually, I got a couple other things yet. Let's go to the minutes on March 28th, 2016. Any comments, questions on those? If not, I'll accept a motion to approve.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carried. Okay, now we'll take up minutes for the 4th of April, 2016. Any comments, questions on those minutes? Seeing none, I accept a motion to approve.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none. How do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone oppose?
I have to abstain. I haven't gotten those yet. Sorry.
Okay. And one abstention. Nobody was opposed.
You didn't get them?
No, I didn't get to them.
Oh.
Gotcha. Okay. Next item. Let's see. The charter, let's go to the Zach letter first. We had a Zach letter, I think, in our packet.
Mm-hmm.
And this is thanking them for all their hard work and being nice about it, and because they did a good job. We only lost one item on town meeting floor.
By 3 votes.
By 3 votes or whatever. And I think we lost it basically on traffic concerns.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and that's not unreasonable. I don't know whether we can fix the traffic concerns for next town meeting yet. Well, I think until you get that right turn lane on Lumber Street, it's going to be mucked up, and we got to fix what we got, and people got to be comfortable. So I'm thinking it's maybe this sits aside for a year until people calm down. And
there's a lot of stuff coming in, and people haven't seen what it's really going to be like.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a lot of, you know, uncertainty. So I think, you know, within a year or so, when you get that, much of that Lumber Street stuff built out, people will get a little better sense of what the reality is. Because this doesn't, well, it depends on who goes in, but it wouldn't necessarily generate that much traffic if it was a low-impact kind of use, but it's the concern. It's the great unknown right now.
Yeah. Okay.
I think one thing about that discussion that was kind of key is I think Sandy's point was without a bypass road there, there's really no way to handle the traffic. And I'm sorry. And the other issue is that some people mentioned that the height of the possible building hotel would be still too high, but I don't think they were really there's no plans or anything like that they're talking about. They're just going by what they feel without the facts, and we didn't present facts necessarily on that, so it was it's hard to convince people of good intentions if they're not willing to hear it.
Particularly the building. I think most people aren't as aware as we were that land drops off towards the 495, and it would not be as visible as it would be, and we could have probably put together a presentation that would have kind of showed that, but we didn't.
And I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
I mean, the fire chief did step up and say that he was working toward a solution.
And the ladder?
So, I don't think it was safety concerned. I think it's more the look and feel of where it is. And, you know, within the next year or so, you know, that Parkwood, 35 Parkwood or whatever, the one at the end that's vacant, been vacant. Mm-hmm. It's got new owners today. The rumor is it's for sale to somebody else at this point. There might be a plan for it, you know, that instead of a town idea of plan, there might be, you know, it. Mm-hmm. It could be just all subdivided in the parking lot full of cars, and, you know, it is what it is. But who knows? But right now, we'll just kind of let that one sit. So anyway, I accept a motion to send the members of the Zoning Advisory Committee a letter of our thanks.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. I have a meeting, I think it is, might be tomorrow night? No, tomorrow night's the candidate's night, right, Claire?
Debate, yeah.
Debate is tomorrow night. It's Wednesday night with the Charter Review Committee. They had sent out a questionnaire. I think, was it on the table tonight?
It was on the table tonight.
It's a couple of emails.
The second half is the questionnaire.
And wherever I lost the paper. But that's okay. I'll find it here. So anyway, if anyone has any feelings about that, why don't, you know, we can either discuss them tonight or you can send their comments and questions. They asked a lot of questions. A lot of it is more like budget stuff like that, which quite frankly is not necessarily where we're at, but, you know, there's very few other little, you know, I don't think there's anyone that thinks that the planning board should be appointed or anything like that major that a charter might want to do. And I don't know whether we've had any really bad issues per se.
Number 5 might be of interest.
Which was?
Should the charter require rotation of board committee chairs on an annual or other periodic basis?
For us, I don't think it's an issue because we're elected and we elect our own chair. I think on appointed boards it might be more of a concern. Not that we face.
Well, I'm not saying it's a concern, but some board members might have feeling one way or the other. I don't know.
I hear you saying some.
It's clearly something they're looking at, so they want feedback on it.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm not hearing anything strong from anyone on this, so I will do my best. I'll probably be asked in my political duties of trying to get people elected, etc. I think there's a lot of smaller positions that could be appointed, like I'll just go out there, commissioners of trust funds and stuff like that, and that quite frankly is a little bit tougher. But anyway, let's see. Anyone wants to come? I think it's got a time on there, or did it not have a time on this one? No, it is.
No, you had to sign up for it, and I don't forget what you signed up for.
I think I signed up for whatever this Wednesday is, I think.
I can look and let everybody know if you want.
That'd be a good idea. But please not 5 people show up.
Yes, please. Can't get a quorum at our meeting, so we'll get a quorum at someone else's meeting.
Let's see. The May 17th agenda is with the selectmen.
Do you still want me to ask for a later time slot?
Yes, to try to accommodate one of our members. The it'll be kind of, I think most of you have sat through one of those before, so it's kind of probably going to run the same way. There'll be nominations of the four people. It's Al Rogers, Brian, which I would hope everyone would support because he brings some continuity to the board. We have a Vincent
Cerulli.
Cerulli, do I know him?
He came to a meeting on when there was talk about Chamberlain with the
okay
with the scenic road.
Got it. Okay, and then Anne Hugh
Beauchamp.
Beauchamp.
She's been before us too.
She's got a big write up on her occupation.
Didn't she leave the CBS?
I think so.
She was, yes.
Yeah. Consulting for education and psychology program.
Okay. But it's also still open until May 17th, so they need
right. more. Right. So anyway, we've got lots of people, those people out in TV land. If you want to be a planning board member and join us till 10 o'clock on Monday nights, this is your opportunity to get out of the house.
And one Tuesday.
Yep.
One Tuesday.
We didn't get a draft of the Verizon letter tonight. So we're not going to do that tonight. Peer proposals. I'm sitting on a bunch.
I haven't even looked at them.
You haven't looked at them.
John hasn't looked at them.
Okay.
I think Elaine looked at them.
We've got to put peer proposals on one of our next agenda items because we've got to spend some time figuring out what we're going to do with that.
When is the contract with Beta up?
Whenever we say, kind of. Oh. Kinda. Okay, other than that, we had a great town meeting. Thanks everyone for all that getting prepared for that.
I've had people want me to ask questions tonight about town meeting, and since it's on the agenda, two items.
Sure.
One is the article that concerns the easement on Leonard Street. I did speak to John Westerling before town meeting, and he ways for stormwater management. But Mr. McBride told me that parcel is landlocked and that he's not certain if the easement is over his property or not. And I don't know what to tell him, so I thought I told him I'd bring it up tonight. And we don't have to have an answer here, but maybe can we research that? And
there's a plan with it, obviously, so let's get the plan out to members. That was not our article. I was just trying to get out of that meeting as quickly as I could and offer a motion, but it was...
I wish we had, because I spoke to Jim Cirello on the Conservation Commission, and they hadn't had a scientist look at the property, and Mr. McBride showed me that previously on that lot, there had been a scientist mark the wetlands, and the wetland is all along that side where his property is. So if there's an easement, it's easement into the wetland.
I had heard that it was right off of where, right across from where we approved the new road. So,
but then where the road ends, there's Mr. Meyer's house, Mr. McBride's, and his family's property.
Yep.
And then that road continues. It's an easement to...
Well, the article was to accept a gift of the easement from somebody in the article. So you can probably figure out who it is.
We looked online, couldn't find anything.
Really? I mean,
I should have asked John today. I didn't have time.
Anyway, let's just, we will sort that out.
That's one question that came up. And then the other thing was Mr. Schmidt just wants it to be clear that we had in a previous town meeting agreed as a town, voted on it, that Franklin Road will go from 135 Hopkinton to 135 and to Ashland as a continuum.
That what we voted at town meeting
was just to remove the name.
Was to advise the selectmen that town meeting felt that the name should be changed. Town meeting has no authority to make a name
Well,
they have no authority to make and change the name. Street names are invested by state statute in the Board of Selectmen.
True. But what I'm saying is that the wheels are kind of falling off the meeting at that juncture, and him getting on the stage and stuff, and then the clarity of their concern was lost in the actions of the meeting. And what they wanted people to know and be clear on is that the town meeting of 2013, the intent was...
Yeah.
The intent was that Franklin Road be go 135 to 135. Now, if Board of Selectmen don't do or don't follow that, that's Board of Selectmen.
Right.
And that they just want the message to be out there that this was already something we had discussed and voted on as a town, and it's up to the Board of Selectmen. The part that they weren't getting was that it's the part of, up to the Board of Selectmen to follow that or not follow that. And
right. So
they follow the
intent of town meeting was to have it changed to Franklin Road instead of Legacy Farms North. But their place wasn't at town meeting. Their place is before the Board of Selectmen.
Right. And they were confused because removing, right now it's not technically named, and then they weren't sure.
No, right now it's technically named Legacy North, because that's the last vote of the Board of Selectmen. If the sign goes up tomorrow, that's what the sign's going to say, because that's what they voted. And Rafferty Road gets changed to Legacy Farms Road North.
And the
rationale for that is we are trying to create a bypass corridor. And we made a very tough turn off of Franklin Road so that Franklin Road looks like a little side street, a little historic side street, so that all the people that are going up there aren't going to take a ride on Franklin Road and go by all the people that were on Franklin Road complaining that they were going to get a lot of extra traffic. So we thought we fixed it.
So I've gotten calls from people on Franklin Road and a bunch of other people that are saying that state money's paying for Legacy Farm North Road, and if we want to have Franklin Road be a continuum as it is historically, then we have every right to expect that, especially since it was brought up at town meeting 2013.
It's up to the Board of Selectmen. How many times are we going to say it?
I agree with that, but when you say something like make an historic road, blah, 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 it's ignoring the fact that it has been discussed at town meeting and been brought up before.
And the Selectmen
It was missed in the town meeting because it was late at night and things kind of got all chaotic at the end. So I just wanted to clarify what their concerns were, and I have been called by people that are concerned about it. And I've also been people saying, well, I didn't even know town meeting happened.
Are you directing them to the Board of Selectmen?
Board of Selectmen have the authority to name the streets.
Right, are you, the people who are contacting you, are you directing them
yes.
to the Board of Selectmen?
Yes.
Because that's really where they need to go.
And I'm saying the planning board, I seconded and made the motion to remove the names of the streets that we were taking the names off of. So I totally understand how the planning board works and how the planning board of selectmen works in this process, but people, average people going to town meeting don't. And some of them don't even get to town meeting because they don't know where it is, and it's like, all right, well, it's every year, so you know, we have to do our best to keep in mind that not everyone knows what we're talking about, not everyone goes to the meetings, not everyone goes to town meeting, but they still have concerns, and when they do go to town meeting and have concerns, we should just make a better effort to maybe understand what those concerns are.
Okay.
And I think we did a pretty good job.
Entertain a motion to close the meeting for Monday, May 9th.
Second.
Was there anything else that we noticed? Did you want to just say that we got these?
We got the decision on Dunkin' Donuts in front of you. Other than that. Motion for adjournment.
Before we adjourn our discussion about it, this is last meeting, at least for right now, two of our members who have served a long time.
Yeah.
And I want to thank them.
One served a long time. One served what feels like a long time.
I remember you stepped up and ran.
And it may not be over yet.
Thank you, Claire and Brian.
Yes, thank you very much.
It's been a great 15 years, guys.
Yeah.
So, all those in favor of adjourning?
Aye.
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 We are adjourned.